Okay, good morning, and welcome to the first class of an eight-part lecture series on Josephus, historian, hero, and traitor. And this is December the 3rd. Right, okay. So, we're going to be studying over, just a reminder, there will be no class next week. We will be meeting in 2 weeks. I had to go out, something came up, I'm going out of town. But then we will be going straight through the rest of December and throughout January. Okay, I will remind you.
You continue to put the lectures on the computer?
On what?
You continue to put the lectures?
Yes, I will continue to put the lectures on up online and send you the link. First of all, please always remember to bring the material from the last time. You need a copy of the complete works of Josephus. This was the relatively cheap edition. I mean, it's everybody. The edition is the old Winston translation. It's available in all kinds of different editions. This just happens to be one. Robert's got one on his Kindle. Just happened to be one that, you know, was quite inexpensive, you know, hardcover, and it's just the complete works, because we will be looking at parts from all of his writing. Okay, so that's kind of the nuts and bolts that we have to begin with. And if you don't have this today, you can share for today. So, why Josephus? Well, Flavius Josephus, as his name was in Latin and Greek, is one of our most important sources for the late Second Temple period. Without Josephus, there would be so many things that we would just not know. So first of all, he's an incredible source. And unlike Philo, Josephus was actually known in the Jewish community. He was forgotten, but then he was rediscovered in the early Middle Ages. So in the early Middle Ages, in the 10th century, already we have evidence of you'll have to follow this carefully, a Hebrew version of a Latin paraphrase of the original Greek. Okay? And it's called the Sefer Yosipon. And I will talk about that in the last class, but through that, and then the Muslims got a hold of it through the Hebrew, so then it was translated into Arabic. A big chunk of Josephus was thereby known to the Jewish community in the Middle Ages. And one of the critical things that was known was the story of Masada, which actually had an impact on the Jews in Ashkenaz, in Germany, on their attitudes towards martyrdom. So we'll get to that eventually. So Josephus was known in the Jewish community before the modern period. Secondly, Josephus was extremely important in the Christian world. As early as the 4th century, Josephus was translated into Latin and spread through the Western Empire. And the reason for Josephus's popularity, and there are numerous medieval manuscripts of the works of Josephus in Latin, was that, first of all, he describes the period of time between the end of the Hebrew Bible and the beginning of the Christian era. So he provides the bridge, historically, for Christians. Secondly, he mentions John the Baptist. He mentions James, the brother of Jesus. And there is a passage about Jesus. Now, most scholars believe that either part or all of this passage is a forgery that was added in by a Christian interpolator. But Christians didn't know that. So they called this the testimony of Jesus. In other words, they saw this. This is the only, for them, this was the only instance of a mention of Jesus outside of the New Testament is in Josephus. Many scholars believe that a small part of the passage is authentic. But as we will eventually get to it, you'll see that it's not possible that the whole passage could be authentic to Josephus, because whoever wrote it was a believing Christian. It's only about a paragraph. But still, this is one of the reasons why Josephus' works became so important. Yeah.
So if he was rediscovered with a Hebrew translation of a Latin paraphrase,
yes.
How was he... this, however, is the full writing, not a paraphrase.
No, this is a direct translation from the Greek. Okay? In other words, Josephus...
So it was preserved in...
Greek, right. I will talk about, you know, what he actually wrote in, but what we have is his works in Greek. There are also translations into other ancient languages like Slavonic. Anywhere where the church was, there were translations, you know, so Latin, Slavonic. And there, you know, there are some differences in manuscripts and a whole variety of things, but the fact is the Greek version of Josephus, which is part of Josephus probably wrote originally in Aramaic, and we don't have that. But nonetheless, what we have here is a translation of the Greek. The Josephon is extremely different from the original. So the other thing that's fascinating about Josephus is, of course, the person himself. He's one of those remarkable historical figures who seems to be at some of the most important events of his day, in a very critical period of history, and manages to survive them, and lives through an entire era. The one other person who comes to mind, who at a, you know, was the Marquis de Lafayette. If any of you know about the Marquis de Lafayette, as a young man, a French officer, he joined the Revolutionary Army of George Washington. He went through the Revolutionary War. He was one of the key figures in the early part of the French Revolution when the moderates took over. He then fled the country. He managed to survive the Napoleonic era, most of it in jail, but nonetheless. And then he not only in his later life came to the United, back to the United States to do kind of a little visit with his former army buddies, but he also participated in the end of his life in the liberal movement sweeping Europe, including the strive for independence of Poland from the Russian Empire. One of these guys, again, who lived through it all and was there. Josephus is like one of those people, as you will see. And as I said, he manages to survive. So this is a bust in a museum in Copenhagen. Took me a long time to track down exactly where it was. Which was thought to be a bust of Josephus. We don't really know whether it is. It was thought to be because he looked Jewish. The nose. And there's actually a certain amount of anti-Semitic online commentary about this picture, which I discovered. But anyway, we don't really know what Josephus looked like. But what's interesting is this is a picture of Josephus in a French medieval manuscript. Showing his writing, and you notice he's wearing the Jewish hat, which is very common in the Middle Ages depiction of Jews. And here's another one showing him with the testimony of Jesus and a scribe named Samuel. So these are two, as I said, many manuscripts from the Middle Ages that of Josephus's writing in Latin, and several of them have illustrations showing him. When I said he was a survivor, first of all, let's take a look at some of the material I've given you. First of all, turn to page 3. This is the world that Josephus lived in. His world was the Roman Empire. He was born into the Roman Empire. He died, into the Roman Empire. And the Roman Empire during his day was almost at its fullest extent. The one part that the Romans had not conquered yet was Mesopotamia, which they did under the Emperor Trajan, but only for a very brief time. So in many ways, he lived during the time of the greatest extent of the Roman Empire. Now, the large letters are the countries. The dark black letters, the larger, are the provinces, each one ruled by a governor. And the smaller ones tend to be sub-provinces. So if you take a look, you'll see Syria, Palestina, and Arabia. Palestina was actually not called that until the time of Hadrian, which is after Josephus. But what you see is that the area we call the Land of Israel and Lebanon and Jordan was a sub-province under the larger province of Syria. And it was an extremely strategically important area. for two reasons. Number one, it was close to the border with the Parthian Empire, which ruled Mesopotamia at this time. The Parthians were the only, during the life of Josephus, were the only major foreign power capable of taking on the empire. And the struggle with the Parthians went on for centuries until the time of the Muslim conquest. So it was very close to the border, and the governor of Syria was responsible for, had several legions under his command, precisely to defend against the Parthians. Yes.
So there was a Syria at that time?
Yes.
I thought it was post-World War
No, no. Syria is technically the name of the province. It goes all the way back to the Assyrians, but it was a province under the under the Persians. It was a province under the Hellenistic Empire, and it was the Romans basically took over the same designation. This is where this is the Roman Empire that Josephus lived under. Secondly, this is the way the land of Israel looked, and for that you're going to go to page 4. Now, during his lifetime, the various makeup of the what we would call the land of Israel changed. In other words, if you take a look at the whole area, except for the coast of what is the Gaza Strip today, Ashkelon, Ashdod, that was, all the way up to Phoenicia, was the kingdom of Herod the Great. And as you will see, it got subdivided. And those subdivisions had different rulers at different periods of time. Sometimes they were the descendants of Herod, and sometimes they were under direct Roman rule by the procurators. And I'll get back to that, because the nature of Roman governance is extremely important in understanding what happened. What we are going to do in this class is look at Josephus, first of all, as a person, his life. We're going to then look at the Jewish world through his eyes. In other words, I'm not going to bring in a lot of other sources. We're going to look at what do we know about the Jewish world from his perspective. Now, there are an awful lot of other sources of the Jewish world at the time, but he's the major one. I mean, the other big one, you know, the Dead Sea Scrolls. But nonetheless, I want to focus on what we know about the Jewish world from his perspective, because Josephus is not a disinterested, objective player. No historian was. He has a particular purpose in what he is writing in each of the books from different periods of time. Here, why don't you use the back of this, since Steve isn't going to be here. So when we're reading Josephus's history or his life, we're not reading an objective account of what happened. But we still learn an awful lot. So it also depends on who he's writing for. And so when he's presenting aspects of the Jewish world, we have to understand he's actually trying to explain the Jewish world to non-Jews, to Romans and Greeks. He's not writing primarily for his own people, although sometimes he is. So we will see the political divisions of the land of Israel are extremely fluid and really have a major impact on what's going on. Just for your own edification, when we get there, when we're talking about the... So first we're going to talk about his life. Then we're going to talk about the Jewish world seen through his eyes, which will include the Pharisees, Sadducees, Essenes. What do we know about Judaism from him? There's a lot we could be doing in that regard, especially when you get down to, like, he has an extensive description of the temple, which actually fits a lot with the modern archaeology. We're not going to spend much time on that because it's so extensive. But so But then we're going to look at his, specifically we're going to look at the war. That's going to take up most of the last part of the class, is what happened in the war with the Romans, which is the first Jewish war, by the way. And so for... What? Well, you'll see that. The war is 66 to 74, because we're going to look at the timeline in a minute. The point is, at that point, the map of Jerusalem will become important, because what happened where is important. And you'll see the dark line on the map. That's the... Those are the walls of Jerusalem, the old city today, which are from Turkish times. You'll see that they follow some of the ancient walls, but the actual walls of Jerusalem in Josephus' day were much bigger than the old city today. Okay? All right. So that's we're going to start with his life. We're going to, you know, talk about the Jewish world, and then we're going to look at the war. So I want to begin, first of all, on the first page, and just look at the timeline. And this timeline, I think, is important for you to bring every week. But for those of you that came in a little late, one of the things I said about why I find Josephus fascinating is he was one of those rare historical figures who lived through an entire era, managed to survive, and was actually there. So just to give you an example of this, he lived through 12 emperors. He was born in the emperor under the emperor Tiberius. These are all nice figures of the emperors. Through Caligula.
That was a feat, I'm sure.
Yes, through Claudius. Through the emperor Claudius. In other words, except for Caesar and Augustus, through the entire Julian dynasty, including Nero. It was under Nero that the war broke out. Then there was the year of the three emperors, Galba, Otho, and Vitellius. And, of course, Vespasian, who was one of his patrons, who was the general in charge of putting down the revolt until he became emperor partway through the war when Nero was killed and the three emperors. There was chaos in Rome. And, of course, his son, Titus, who was the one responsible for the destruction in the temple in Jerusalem. I suppose I should say, Yimach Shemo, may his name be erased. Under Titus's brother, Domitian, who was the three emperors of Vespasian, Titus, and Domitian are called the Flavian dynasty because they came from the clan of Flavius, which Josephus took his Latin name, Flavius Josephus, from his patrons. And we know that he lived into the next era, Nerva, and he died sometime during the rule of Trajan, probably around the year 100. So that's incredible that one person could have survived that whole period, 12 Caesars.
What was it? How many years was that?
Well, he was born around 37. Is that what I've got? Yes, 37, and he died around sometime after the year 100. We know exactly when he was born because he tells us. We don't know when he died, but we know from his writing they had to have lived to the year 100, but we don't hear about him after that, so we assume that he did. So for his day, he lived a fairly long life.
Yeah.
You know? One other interesting thing that is worthwhile for you to sort of keep an eye on, and I don't expect you to go the ins and out of, it's on page 6, it's the family tree of Herod the Great, and one of the great things about reading Josephus on the in his Jewish history before the war is to read this incredible soap opera that is the life of Herod and his descendants. But the two critical figures in this family tree on the bottom half are Agrippa I and Agrippa II. Agrippa I was Herod's grandson, who for a few years ruled over the entire territory that his grandfather had ruled over. And in fact, it's with the death of Agrippa I in 44 that the political situation in Judea begins to decline and leads towards the war some 22 years later. And Agrippa II, the great-grandson of Herod the Great, lived during the war, was part of the group of Jews who tried to stop the war, who was supportive of the Romans, and eventually became a good friend of Josephus. And Josephus's latter years, which he lived in Rome, he did so partly under the patronage of Agrippa II, who also had kind of retired to Rome.
I'm sorry, Rabbi, your voice was drowned out by someone eating. Who is that person you were talking about?
Agrippa II. In other words, Josephus probably, you know, he was too young to know Agrippa I, but he was a friend of Agrippa II and talks about him. And one of the ways we can date the last years of Josephus is he talks about Agrippa II, about him dying, so we know when Agrippa II died, and Josephus survived him by some years. Okay? So those are going to be key figures in the narrative that's going to go on. One of the interesting things is that one of our most important archaeological sources for the period are the coins that were minted by the Jewish revolutionaries during the revolt. They took silver from the temple treasury and they minted their own coins for each year, practically each year of the war. They started running out of silver, so they started doing bronze. But so here's an example of a shekel from the third year, 68. And you'll notice the letters. This is Hebrew. This is the original Hebrew alphabet that was probably seen at the time as being on a higher level of holiness than the alphabet that we use now, what's called the Assyrian alphabet. And the reason I say that is that in some of the Dead Sea Scrolls that have biblical texts, whenever the four-letter name of God, Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, is used, it's done in the old Hebrew alphabet rather than the square alphabet. So the revolutionaries used the old alphabet, and they dated when this was. This is a chalice, and this these are probably pomegranates, which was one of the decorations on the high priest's garments. And it says here, Jerusalem the Holy. Which gives you a sense that this is, you know, the religious element in it. Here's a bronze pruta from 6970, and on this side it says for the redemption of Zion, and includes two things that are quite common in Jewish mosaics of synagogue floors and other decorations: the lulav and etrog, because Sukkot was such an important festival during the days of the temple. This will be part of it. So what I want you to do now is to take a look on page one at the timeline, which I'm going to go through and point out some very important events. But this is the kind of thing you should keep with you at all times, because I tried to make it as detailed as possible, except when it comes to the specifics of the war. I'll probably, when we get to the war, give you a much more detailed timeline of the war itself. But again, we're talking about the Roman period of the land of Israel and of the Jewish people. And the Romans conquered that part of the Near East in the 60s BCE. And Pompey, the great general, Roman general Pompey, conquered the land of Israel, Judea, as an intervention into a civil war between the two brothers who were the aspirants to the throne of the Hasmoneans, in other words, the descendants of the Maccabees. So there was a civil war, and Pompey intervened on the side of one of the brothers and basically stayed. And at that point, the Romans occupied Judea and all the other areas in that area, and they went between direct rule and rule by a vassal. So for a number of years, one of the Hasmoneans, one of the brothers, continued to be sort of partially in charge, but then it went to direct Roman rule, and then in 37, the whole area, again, not just Judea, but Samaria, the Galilee, that whole area on the map was given to Herod the Great, or who we call Herod. And Herod, starting with his father, had been supporters of the Romans. Herod was an incredibly canny politician. He, because what in that period, of course, in Roman history, you have the civil wars going on in Rome between Julius, what happened before the death of Julius Caesar. Julius Caesar fighting with Pompey for supremacy, and eventually Caesar winning out, Caesar getting assassinated, and then the civil war between Octavian, who later becomes Augustus, and Mark Antony. And Herod was originally a supporter of Mark Antony and the Queen of Egypt, Cleopatra. When they were defeated, somehow Herod managed to get on the good side of Augustus. He survived. And he became one of the most important supporters of Rome in the Near East.
Is this the Herod who built the palace at Masada?
Yes. That's Herod the Great. He's the one who rebuilt the temple. He built Herodion. He built the city of Caesarea. All right. In other words, Herod was responsible for incredible building projects, which are still visible. If you go to the Tomb of the Patriarchs in Hebron, the essential structure was built by Herod. So Herod was of Idumean descent. The Idumeans had been forcibly converted to Judaism by one of the Maccabean Hasmonean kings. And so they are Jewish, but they are not ethnically Judean. And so sometimes Herod's Jewishness was called into question, but he was definitely Jewish, because you have to understand there were different ethnic forms of Jews, even though they were Judean by religion. So there were Idumean Judeans, there were Judean Judeans, there were Galilean Judeans, plus all the other Jews from the diaspora. So Herod was of Idumean descent. And he married one of his many wives. If you look at his family tree, he had a whole bunch of wives, several of whom he executed. One of his wives was a descendant of the Hasmonean, the royal house. So he was an incredibly important figure. And as you see, he ruled for quite a long time, for over 30 years. Now, there was some dissent that went on in the Jewish world, in Judea and the Galilee especially, during the time of Herod. But there were what might call minor revolts or whatever, and you'll see Josephus' terms for who these people are is very interesting because he has different ways of referring to these people. Sometimes he refers to them as brigands, meaning it could just be, kind of local bandits. But it may, in fact, be more than that. That's a discussion of scholars. But when Herod dies, his kingdom is split up into three parts, and that's on the map showing the divisions of his three sons, Archelaus, Philip, and Herod Antipas. And
the map on page...
The map on page 4. You will see the various lines describe which ones under who, okay? So Archelaus got Judea and Samaria, and the others got various other parts. Now, Archelaus turned out to be an incredibly bad ruler, and in 6 CE, he was banished. But what happened was is that in the same year that Herod died, and we're not 100% sure of this year, by the way, there was a major outbreak of violence in Judea. which was put down viciously by the Roman the governor of Syria, who's a guy by the name of Varus, who, by the way, not too long after, was killed in a major battle in Germany and was considered, his name was considered with great shame afterwards in the Teutonburg Forest. Several Roman legions were wiped out, and basically it caused the Romans to sort of draw the line in where they were going to go no further into Germany. But the point is, Varus, this is known amongst in scholarly circles as the War of Varus, where several thousand Jews were killed because of riots that took place. This is the beginning of a period of a certain amount of unrest, not huge unrest, but outbreaks. So in 6, Archelaus is banished for his incompetence, and Judea is incorporated into the Roman provincial system. Now, what happens is that because Judea was not a province, but a sub-province, they got somebody called a procurator to be the ruler of Judea. Now, a procurator was somebody who was not from the Roman patrician class. The governors of the provinces were all of the patrician class. You have to understand, Rome had a fairly rigid class system. The top of the heap were the patricians. The second level were, it's often translated as the knights, but it's a secondary class. And then you get the plebes. And so a governor had to be of the patrician class. A procurator could be of the knight class, which meant they often were not as good quality, be perfectly honest with you. As you will see, one of the biggest problems that, and you know, they were, all these things are political offices. You'll see that the procurators of Judea, for the most part, ended up being a really not a terribly good group of men overall.
Incompetent or
incompetent and corrupt. Sometimes they weren't, but it's not like once they were in, that was the end. Several of them got recalled, banished, you know, for their incompetence. And, you know, if they allowed, and what did the Romans want? The Romans wanted stability. They wanted stability because of how important and strategic Judea was. They didn't want riots to break out. They didn't want the Jewish population dissatisfied. And the other thing you have to understand is that from the time of Julius Caesar, and this was affirmed by Augustus, Jewish religious practice was protected under Roman law. The Romans had the Jews had certain privileges throughout the empire that protected them and their religious practice. Namely, they did not have to worship the emperor. They could give sacrifices in honor of the emperor in the Jerusalem temple, but they didn't have to worship the emperor as a god. They could not be called to court on the Sabbath. They could not be conscripted into the army. They could join the army if they wanted. And there were, so, and the Jewish religion was not supposed to be interfered with by the government or the army. And that's exactly what happens sometimes when the procurator is not sensitive to Jewish religious sensibilities, or there's something that a Roman soldier does, which is deemed to be offensive to the Jewish population. And that causes a riot to break out. The other side of the coin is that there were Jews who saw the destruction of Jewish self in Jewish self dependence, self determination, which had occurred because of the Maccabean revolt, to be something really disgraceful. That the temple Judea was not under a Jewish ruler, and of course they saw that the Maccabees had defeated an empire and gained independence. They had that example, unfortunately. I will talk later on about the counter-argument, the philosophy of God wants us to be ruled by the Romans so we don't revolt. We'll get to that because that, in fact, ends up being Josephus's own personal philosophy, but it's something that was very common at the time. So what happens is in 6, Archelaus is banished. Judea becomes incorporated. Now, the advantage of this, of course, is that the high priest, the Kohen Gadol of the temple, in effect becomes the political head of state under the Romans. The high priest, by the way, at this point, gets appointed by the Romans from a particular group of priestly families, but it's they're no longer the office of the high priest becomes a political office. And depending upon who the high priest is in the times, the high priest is sometimes venerated by the population, other times hated by the population. And also you see that in 6 there is a minor revolt takes place by a guy named Judas the Galilean in the Galilee. And the Galilee seems to be a hotbed of revolutionaries. What's interesting is that we don't know a lot about Judas. He's only mentioned, really, in Josephus. But we do know that several of his descendants actually continued this kind of thing. If you go all the way down where is it here? 46. Tiberius Alexander, who happens to be the nephew of Philo of Alexandria, a Jew who went over to the side of the Romans, and became a very high official in the Roman Empire. He is the procurator of Judea for 2 years, and he executes the sons of Judas the Galilean, Simon and James, for another uprising in the Galilee. So this guy seems to have a family of revolutionaries. The point is, you will see I put down every single procurator in this period. 26 to 36 is Pontius Pilate. He's one of the longer-serving ones, apparently under Tiberius. He tended to keep people there for quite a while. But after him, you'll notice they are there for short periods of time. And that's one of the problems. But Pilate, just one second, Pilate was one of the ones who got recalled because of his incompetence and because of riots and various other things. He was recalled. And exiled, by the way, for his failures. Yes, Robert.
Well, I don't understand the difference between the procurator and the political head of state that the high priest had become. It seems like it should be the same thing.
It's not. The procurator did not live in Jerusalem. The procurator's headquarters was in Caesarea. That was the Roman headquarters in the area. The regular army was not in Jerusalem. They used auxiliaries, which are kind of second-class soldiers, not the legions. So the procurator was responsible to make sure that the sub-province paid its taxes to the empire, the security of the area. But the high priest ruled Jerusalem and Judea on the day-to-day basis. In other words, the high priest had his own police force, kept the peace on the Temple Mount, ran the temple and all its administration. And since the temple was the central institution of Judea, that was extremely important. The temple had a huge treasury because it was a site of pilgrimage by Jews from all around the Jewish world, including from outside the Roman Empire. So the day-to-day ruling of Judea was done by the high priest and his council, known as the Sanhedrin, which, by the way, was not the Sanhedrin the way the rabbis depicted it, but nonetheless, the high priest had a ruling council called the Sanhedrin. Mostly, again, really concerned primarily with Jerusalem, and the Sanhedrin was made up of several different groups. Mostly, probably dominated by what we would call the patrician class of Judea, but also, so there were Sadducees, but there were also some Pharisees represented on the council as well. So that's the difference. Does that answer your question?
The way I'm trying to put it together would be like the president of the United States and the governor of the state.
Yeah, pretty much. Or it's what you have is you have the imperial. You have the imperial, the representative of the emperor, the imperial government, and you have the local, what we would call ethnarch, ruler of the local group, okay, ethnic enclave. So what you'll see after that is the various procurators. And it's during the time of the Emperor Tiberius, just the year of his death, Flavius Josephus, as he's later known, is born. His born name is Joseph ben Matthias, Yosef ben Matatyahu. And we will see he comes from a fairly prominent family. Now, one of the situations then, the situation in the late 30s, early 40s, for a while declines for two reasons. First of all, there are the riots between Jews and Greeks in Alexandria. For those who study file with me know that that was a really devastating event. And a deputation of Jews from Alexandria, including Philo in his old age, went to talk to Caius Caligula. And during the time they were in Rome, Caligula was assassinated. And it was also during the time when Caligula decided to put a statue of himself in the Jerusalem temple, which could have caused the war to break out at that point. Fortunately, the governor of Syria at the time, Petronius, was an incredibly smart person and wrote a letter back to Caligula saying, are you really sure you want to do this? And between the back and forth of the letters, he delayed this whole thing because the Jewish community basically said to him, we're going to sit down on the road before where the statue is going to come, and you're going to have to kill every single one of us. We are not going to allow this to happen. And Petronius knew that this would completely open up a civil war. Fortunately for everybody's concern, Caligula was assassinated. And Claudius, of course, stopped all of this. And it was under Claudius, during the time of Claudius, that he appointed the grandson of Herod, Herod Agrippa I, to be king over the whole area that Herod had originally done, meaning that Agrippa took over the territories of what had been his uncles, Philip and Herod Antipas. And the reason why is because Herod Agrippa was a close friend of Claudius, and in fact was instrumental, according to Josephus, in getting to Claudius to become emperor. He was there at the time in Rome. And for any of you who saw the television series I, Claudius, right, Herod Agrippa is a character in the series. Right. Interestingly enough, what was his name? The English fellow who was introduced the series, was it Kenneth Clark? He misidentified Herod Agrippa as Herod Antipas in his introduction. Interestingly enough, piece of trivia for you. Anyway, but Herod only lives for a few years after he's appointed king, and Claudius immediately goes back to direct Roman rule in Judea. The other parts are then given to other descendants of Herod the Great. So, but Judea now again becomes directly ruled, including by Tiberius Alexander. Now, the situation begins, as you see, begins to decline in those years. Under Vendentius Cumanus, who was a terrible procurator, riots broke out in Jerusalem and in the countryside of Judea. There were also conflicts between Jews and Samaritans that led to an uprising by a guy named Eleazar ben Dinai. So his period was particularly bad. And then under the next one, Felix, the situation got even worse. And there's the rise of a group called the Sicarii. And the Sicarii are named after the little sickle-shaped knives they used to assassinate people. So you can translate their name as the knife men. And one of the things they did is they assassinated the high priest Jonathan in 59, which was huge. And essentially the Sicarii went about assassinating not Romans, but Jews who they accused of being collaborators with the Roman government. And what they would do is, according to Josephus, they would go into a crowd of people with their knives under their garments. They would, saddle up to somebody, stab them, and then start yelling, "Oh no, so-and-so has been stabbed," as if they were not the perpetrator of it. So they caused a great deal of fear. The Sicarii ended up being involved in the war, but I'll tell you about them when we get to that. But the point is, you're now getting a period of incredible instability going on, where there's a lot of discontent, and it's really exacerbated by the by the ineptness of the procurators Commodus and Felix. After the death of Claudius, you have the Emperor Nero, who seems to, you know, Nero, of course, doesn't end up being a very good emperor, and also seems to appoint really bad procurators in Judea. And what's interesting is just in the few years before the war in during the time of Albinus, there's actually an internal struggle within the priesthood of Jerusalem as to who's going to be the high priest and who's going to rule. In 64, when Josephus was quite young, he led a delegation, being a priest himself, a Kohen himself, to Rome to free some priests who were being held hostage by the Roman government because of things that had been going on. And it's probably there that he makes a lot of contacts in Rome and sees the power and might of the Roman Empire. So, as I said, things go from bad to worse. Gessius Florus becomes the procurator in 64, and maybe it didn't matter who became the procurator, but Florus also was particularly bad, and it was under him that the war broke out. And the war was not planned. Yes?
The term of the procurators seemed to be 2 years. Was that a term of office, or did they only last?
They tended after the time of Tiberius, they all seemed to have extremely short periods of time. Sometimes they were using this as a way to move up the ladder of political power. They were often associated with friends of the emperor. They were closely associated. In other words, it was a political office to which they may have paid for. It just seemed to be a policy that they were not in power for very long, okay? And that's part of the problem, that they didn't know the population. They were often, insensitive or ignorant of Jewish customs and the populace. So it's just what happened and led to the instability. Really led to the instability of the period. So the war is not planned. It begins with riots that break out in Caesarea. And Caesarea is a city which is sort of half the population is Jewish and half the population is Greek or Greek-speaking. And it is the relative status of those communities that had been a problem for years. And so there are riots break out, and then the riots spread to Jerusalem. And it's then that it becomes an official an official revolt. Interestingly enough, the first act that is technically a revolutionary act is the decision by the chief of staff of the priests to cease the sacrifice in honor of the emperor. That is considered the break. And the initial government is a provisional government made up of a whole bunch of factions, including the moderates. Remember, there are a lot of the people, a lot of the various Jewish authorities do not want to get involved in this. And so there's a moderate faction that is trying to control the situation. And initially, militarily, they in fact chase out the Roman forces in the whole area, Judea, the Galilee, which are not the regular legions, by the way. The Roman governor of Syria tries to put down the revolt. He is defeated, interestingly enough. So for a couple of years, they seem to be winning. But then the Romans gather legions and they send Vespasian to attack. He starts with an invasion of Galilee. And by the way, not all the cities of the Galilee went into the revolt. Some of them refused to get involved. And bit by bit, Vespasian reduces the Galilee. But before he is able to move on to Jerusalem, you then have this year of the three emperors where Nero is killed, and you have this incredible political instability going on in Rome. So in many ways, the whole operation against the revolutionaries stops. Vespasian is proclaimed emperor, by many of the legions in the East. And by the way, good old Tiberius Alexander, who at this by this point is the governor of Egypt, he's really made his way up. He backs Vespasian. And so the backing of Tiberius Alexander with his legions, because there are legions stationed in Egypt, is critical in the success of Vespasian. Vespasian goes back to Rome, puts down any opponents, becomes emperor, and then his son Titus takes over the war. And it's under Titus that ultimately Jerusalem falls. But as you see in 66 to 68, you have the provisional government is headed by the high priest Ananus, so it is a very moderate thing. But then in 68, you get a more radical group, what's called the Zealot Coalition. And then you get an even more radical group headed by a guy by the name of Simon Bar Giora. So what happens is the revolutionaries become increasingly radicalized and less likely to accept any kind of compromise or ability to sort of stop the war, to negotiate with the Romans. And as a result, the city falls, the temple is destroyed. And a few years, that doesn't end the war, by the way. It's another 4 years before all of the pockets of resistance are destroyed, including Masada. It doesn't fall till 74. What happens is, we'll talk about Josephus's publications, but just if you go down, you'll see there is a second war between 115 and 117. We don't have a lot of details because over the course is after Josephus died, so we don't have a source like Josephus for that war. But the Jews in Egypt, Cyprus, and Cyrenaica break out into revolts against the Romans. Under Trajan and Hadrian, they are ruthlessly put down. It really is the end of the Jewish community of Alexandria as a major cultural center. The Jews of Cyprus are completely wiped out, and Jews are forbidden to go onto Cyprus, and Cyrenaica, which is Tunisia today, is also reduced. So that's the second war. Again, we don't know a lot about it because we don't have that many sources in detail. And of course, even worse, and by the way, Judea did not participate in that revolt. And the final war between the Jews and the Romans was the Bar Kokhba revolt between 132 and 135, put down by the Emperor Hadrian. And in terms of actual numbers of people who died, that was worse than the first war. And that's it. After that, no Jews revolted against the Romans after that. That was the last major Jewish revolt against the ruling power till the 20th century. Seriously.
The Romans ruled until...
The Muslim period, if you count the Byzantine Empire as being just the Eastern Roman Empire, yes. Until the Muslim conquest, it's Roman rule.
The basis for the Jewish revolt that led to the Three Wars was that they were against Roman imperialism, or Rome was stopping them worshipping as Jews?
We will get to that. It's a very complex thing as to why, and I think it's a number of different factors. Again, the war was not a planned revolt. There were political and social and economic issues that led to the revolt, and there were also religious issues. In other words, they're all wrapped up together. We'll get to that. So if you turn to page 7, we're going to focus on Josephus. But does anybody have any final questions about sort of that historical outline? Again, I suggest you bring this outline with you, so when we mention certain things, you'll know where it falls on the timeline. And when we get to the war itself, I'll give you a more detailed timeline of what happened during the war. But on page 7...
I just say, it made me think, the more things change, the more they stay the same. Thinking of the Middle East today and the empires and comings and goings.
Yeah. So, excuse me for chewing. We have 4 works of Josephus. The first work, written some 5 to 10 years after the war, is called The Jewish Wars. We know that he originally wrote it in Aramaic because he himself admits he wasn't that proficient in Greek. And we know he had some secretaries who translated it into Greek. We absolutely have no fragments of the original Aramaic, none whatsoever. Some 10 years later, he wrote a book called The Antiquities of the Jews. The Jewish wars start with the Maccabean Revolt. So they start some 250 years before the War of the Romans, because Josephus felt that the roots of the war go back to the Maccabean Revolt. So he gives you the history of the Jewish world from the Maccabean Revolt to his own day, and then the war. Now, the Jewish wars are written in seven books. The seventh book is probably a later add-on. It seems at the end of book six, he's kind of sort of finished with it. It looks like book seven was added later. Okay?
And we have full copies of these in whatever translation?
Yeah, the original Greek. We have it, the whole thing. The second work he did about 10 years later, which was in effect to write an entire history of the Jews from the creation of the world down to the Maccabean Revolt. In other words, he wanted to fill in the rest of Jewish history, which he did. What you have to understand in the process of doing these things, he tells us a lot about the world he lives in. Like, there's a whole section of the Jewish wars devoted to how the Roman army is organized. There's a whole section, you know, description of Jerusalem and the temple. In other words, these are asides. He does this. So the Antiquities of the Jews is this work, which apparently, while he was trying to finish it, he got kind of tired of writing it, as he says, and parts of it may have been finished by other people. And then towards the end of his life, he wrote a work which was originally just an appendix to the Antiquities, which we call The Life. It's an autobiography. It's the first autobiography in Western culture. Nobody had written an autobiography, or at least none that survive, before this. It's the first surviving autobiography. As you will see, a lot of it is taken up with a self-justification as to why he decided to go over to the Romans, and we'll get to that. But he also, the last work he wrote around the same time, was a book we call Against Apion, which probably was not its original name. It's a rejoinder to what we would call a bunch of anti-Semites or anti-Jewish Greeks, and refuting their scurrilous claims and attacks on the Jewish religion. It's a very interesting work. And some of the people he attacks, he quotes in detail, and those are the only known parts of those works exist, are in quotation from him. So that's the last thing we know we have of him. And of course, he's asserting the superiority of Judaism and that, and so on and so forth. Now, where did he get his material? Well, the Hebrew Bible. When I say the Hebrew Bible, the Tanakh, he probably had a Tanakh that was more or less the same we have it today in terms of the number of books and which books. At one point, he actually tells us, what the Jewish scriptures are made up of, and he says there are 22 books, but if you just count Lamentations as part of Jeremiah and Ruth as part of the book of Judges, you end up with 22. He's pretty much talking about what we've got today. We're almost 100% sure. And he does seem to be talking about them as if it is the whole collection is what we would call a sacred canon, meaning designated as sacred scripture. But sometimes he quotes other stuff, and he doesn't always make a distinction between what we would call biblical and non-biblical material in terms of who he's quoting. So it's a little iffy sometimes. We know that some cases, because his work is in Greek, the form of the Bible that is quoted is in fact the Septuagint. That when it was translated from Aramaic into Greek, they used the Septuagint, which is the Alexandrian translation of the Bible into Greek. he sometimes uses that translation instead of quoting directly from the Hebrew in translation. They use the Septuagint translation. Yes, Rabbi.
On what you said that he doesn't, there's some not like other sources that he is quoting at the same time as the Tanakh that he's including in that.
Yeah.
Would that potentially be things from the Targum you're referring to?
I think it's some of it is may have been apocryphal stuff. The point is, it's not always clear when he is quoting something that he considers officially sacred scripture or not. Not 100%. Okay?
You once told us what the LXX was, and I forgot.
It means 70 because it was created by 70 scholars. So right. The short form for the Septuagint is the LXX.
Right.
He quotes a lot, or he uses, a guy named Nicholas of Damascus, who was the court historian and a philosopher for Herod the Great. Now, Nicholas wasn't Jewish, and Nicholas's work does not survive, but Josephus even tells us that he is quoting or using Nicholas. So for a lot of the period of the stories of the Herod and his family, he is using Nicholas of Damascus as his source. We know that also for the Hasmonean dynasty and the description of some of the Jewish sects, he's using some unknown Hebrew source. He also obviously is using 1 Maccabees when he's talking about the Hasmonean revolt. I don't know if he uses 2 Maccabees, but 1 Maccabees for sure. He, of course, has his own personal recollections of what happened and the recollections of Agrippa II, who he's friends with. So it's evident that some of his source material is from Agrippa II, who was there at some of these events. Of course, Josephus was there at a lot of the events in the war. He wasn't there at everything. Like, he wasn't at Masada. So everything he tells us about Masada, he got secondhand, or he made it up. That's a whole other issue. He had access, because he was living in Rome, and because he was under the patronage of Vespasian and Titus, he had access to their personal accounts of the war, which don't exist anymore. You know the way Caesar, we have Caesar's, works on his wars in Gaul and so on? Well, Vespasian wrote his own work on the Judean revolt, and so did Titus. Those works don't survive, but Josephus tells us that he had access to these, to the imperial campaign records, you might say. We know there's some unknown Roman sources that he also refers to, and probably some other Jewish sources, including possibly accounts of refugees and other eyewitnesses. And lastly, we know that he was influenced generally by Greek sources, and his and this could partly be his own secretaries who assisted in the Greek translations. There are allusions to various Greek literature. We don't know whether he wrote it or his secretaries did it. But you can see different allusions to earlier Greek literature in his writing. Yeah.
How come his work survived when all of the other primary sources have disappeared?
Because of the Christian church. Because I don't know if you were here when I said it, but the Christians saw him as his work was translated into Latin in the early fourth century. And for the Western Empire, the Western Christianity, the Latin speaking, he became their source for history between the end of the Hebrew Bible and their earliest Christian sources. And there is a part in Josephus that talks about Jesus. As I said before, this is probably a forgery, either all or part of it. But because it was there, Josephus is the only place outside the New Testament where Jesus is mentioned in ancient literature.
And it was because of that.
Yes.
And that alone.
Yes.
That this source has survived.
Yes, that his works were preserved. Absolutely. And as I mentioned, there was, by the early Middle Ages, a Jewish paraphrase of Josephus. So Josephus was known, again, it was a Hebrew translation of a Latin paraphrase of Josephus called the Sefer Yosipon that we know existed as early as the 10th century. And that was well known amongst Jews, and it had the story of Masada.
Yeah,
We'll at the end of the class, hopefully we'll get to Sefer Yosipan. Now, we have other sources for the period, obviously. We have the works of Philo. We have the works of the Roman historian Tacitus. We have Suetonius. By the way, Suetonius's Lives of the Caesars was the primary source for Robert Graves for his works of I, Claudius and Claudius the God. He gives us all the gossip of the Caesars from Julius to, I think he goes as far as Domitian. Anyway, we have Dio Cassius, another Roman historian. We have the New Testament, even though it's not a historical work. There's, of course, all the apocryphal and pseudepigraphal works. Those are Jewish and some of them are Christian. We have rabbinic literature, but rabbinic literature is written down hundreds of years later, so we have to be very careful with it. And we have the archaeological evidence, including, as I pointed out, the coins minted by the revolutionaries. There's been a lot of archaeological work that's been done in Jerusalem around the temple. We know a lot about the temple from archaeological discoveries. And what's interesting is a lot of those discoveries confirmed most of what Josephus said about the temple. For example, he said that on the southwest corner of the temple enclosure, there was a place where one of the priests would mount on Friday before the Sabbath and blow a shofar to announce the coming of the Sabbath, which, by the way, is done in religious neighborhoods in Jerusalem to this day. And when they were digging around the south wall area of Jerusalem, they found the debris from the destruction of the temple when the Romans kind of knocked all the walls down. They found this cornerstone that was the cornerstone of the southwest, and it had written on it in Hebrew, the place of the blowing of the shofar. So that's just one example of the ways in which archaeology, not 100%, but in many ways confirmed his description of the temple. Yes, Harvey, you had a question.
No, not a question. Blowing the shofar to announce the Sabbath arrival. My mother tells the story of a man going around the shtetl with a grager in the shulerein and shulerein.
Yes, not uncommon that people would had somebody went around to do that. Okay, so we are now going to look at the life of Josephus. So, again, for those who don't have it this week, please try to remember to get a copy of the complete works of Josephus, because from here on in, we'll be reading a lot of it. If you don't have it with you today, you can share. It's an old translation, quite easily available in many different forms, many different editions, and quite inexpensive. So we're going to look at page one, which is, in this, they didn't put this chronologically in how he wrote it. They put his life first. So we're going to look, first of all, at his early life, which is on page one, where he just tells you exactly where he's from. So, Suzanne, you got it. Why don't you read it?
The family from which I am derived is not an ignoble one, but hath descended all along from the priests. And as nobility among several people is of a different origin, so with us to be of the sacerdotal dignity is an indication of the splendor of a family. Now I am not only sprung from a sacerdotal family in general, but from the first of the 24 courses. And as among us there is not only a considerable difference between one family of each course and another, I am of the chief family of that first course also.
Okay, so he is of priestly descent. He is a Kohen. And the priestly families in the Second Temple period were divided into 24 courses, where each of the courses would have they went in rotation as to who was servicing the temple for a particular period of time. The courses, in fact, are in the books of Ezra and Chronicles, so we have biblical sources for the courses, and he claims to be from the first one, therefore the most prominent.
So a course is what again?
It's the
rotation.
The rotation. It's the priestly rotation.
No.
The group of priests would do the sacrifices for a certain period of time, and then they would. Then the next group would come. In other words, it was a way of rotating amongst all the priestly families who got to do the sacrifices and run the temple for a particular period of time.
For a period of time.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Okay. And this is described, as I said, in Ezra and in the Chronicles and so on. So he's telling us exactly which one he is from. Okay, so then he's not only from like a really important priestly family, although he's not from the high priestly families. And the high priestly families, of course, was an issue because it depended upon which high priestly family you were descended from. The Hasmoneans, after the Maccabean revolt, became the high priests, even though they were not of the family that was supposed to be the high priest. Nonetheless, there was a certain cachet by Josephus's day. The real legitimate line of the high priests were the people from the line of Tzadok, who was the high priest under King Solomon. But be that as it may, go on. I am of the chief.
Nay further.
Nay further
by my mother, I am of the royal blood. For the children Asamoneus, from whom that family was derived, had both the office of the high priesthood and the dignity of a king for a long time.
So he claims through his mother that he's related to the Hasmonean royal family. Quite possible. He's probably not lying here. I mean, it's quite possible that he was. There were probably lots of descendants of the Hasmoneans. All right, go on. I will accordingly.
You want to go through all of them? Yeah. I will accordingly set down my progenitors in order.
So he's going to give us his family tree.
My grandfather's father was named Simon, with the addition of Psellus. He lived at the same time with that son of Simon the high priest, who first of all the high priests was named Hyrcanus. This Simon Psellus had 9 sons, one of whom was Matthias, called Ephlius. He married the daughter of Jonathan the high priest, which Jonathan was the first of the sons of Asamoneus, who was high priest, and was the brother of Simon the high priest also. This Matthias had a son called Matthias Curtis, and that in the first year of the government of Hyrcanus. His son's name was Joseph, born in the 9th year of the reign of Alexandra. His son Matthias was born in the 10th year of the reign of Archelaus, as was I born to Matthias in the first year of the reign of Caius Caesar.
That's Caligula. So he's just given us his yichus, which is really good. Go on.
I have 3 sons. Hyrcanus, the eldest, was born in the 4th year of the reign of Vespasian, as was Justus, born in the 7th, and Agrippa in the 9th.
Now, notice Hyrcanus is a very common Jewish name, by the way. It's so common it becomes Jewish. So there are rabbis named Hyrcanus. Eliezer ben Hyrcanus was one of the great rabbis at the end of the 1st century, beginning of the 2nd, and his son was named Hyrcanus. So Hyrcanus becomes a Jewish name, like Alexander becomes a Jewish name. Notice his second son is referred to as Justus, and his third, Agrippa, after his friend Agrippa II, okay? Again, Agrippa becomes a fairly common Jewish name.
This is off of a Greek translation, so would he have used an Aramaic?
Yeah.
Know the same?
Yeah, what I'm saying is some of these names may never not have had a original Hebrew. I mean, we know his Josephus obviously comes from Yosef, right? Some of them probably had, Jews had both Greek names and Hebrew names, right? Go on.
Thus have I set down the genealogy of my family as I have found described in the public records, and so bid adieu to those who calumniate me as of a lower original.
Okay, and the records, of course, were the fact that the priests had genealogical records to make sure who was properly descended. Most of those records got destroyed in the war, though. Because the temple was burned. That's where the archives were. Go on.
Now my father Matthias was not only eminent on account of his nobility, but had a higher commendation on account of his righteousness, and was in great reputation in Jerusalem, the greatest city we have.
So he's giving due respect to his father.
I was myself brought up with my brother, whose name was Matthias, for he was my own brother by both father and mother.
Meaning a full brother.
Mm-hmm. And I made mighty proficiency in the improvements of my learning, and appeared to have both a great memory and understanding. Moreover, when I was a child and about 14 years of age, I was commended by all for the love I had to learning. On which account the high priests and principal men of the city came then frequently to me together, in order to know my opinion about the accurate understanding of points of the law.
Now listen to this, okay? He's 14 years old, and he's claiming to be so knowledgeable in Jewish tradition that the high priests and wise men come and ask him questions. Now, does this sound familiar?
Yes, Jesus in the...
Exactly. There's a story about Jesus was the same. This is a kind of typical sort of... childhood genius story that went around in the ancient world.
So, hey, rabbinic stories like this all the time.
Exactly. There are rabbinic stories about it. So it's one of those, so again, you know, whether this is true or not, this is a common literary motif. The boy genius.
Right. It's what his mother told him. Yeah. It's really interesting to me. Clearly, modesty was not one of the conditions of people who were in public. Like, to do this, if wrote a book like this today, you'd be like...
he's no shrinking violet, but also, as he's writing this book to counter people who are attacking his credentials and his account of the war. Okay, so he's fighting back. This work is polemical in nature. You have to understand that. So he's got to build up himself and justify what he has done in his life. Because there were Jews who thought he was a traitor. He went over to the Romans. And he continued to live. He went to Rome. He lived there under the patronage of the emperors, the very people who destroyed Jerusalem. How could he do this?
So here he's defending himself really in Jewish circles.
Yeah, he's defending himself, and this thing is defending this particular work. Thank you for pointing that out. Is really a defense amongst his own people for what he did in his life. Remember, he's looking back on his whole life now, and he's living the high life in Rome, essentially. Go on. And when I was about 16.
And when I was about 16 years old, I had a mind to make trial of the several sects that were among us.
This is a really interesting passage.
These sects are three. The first is that of the Pharisees, the second that of the Sadducees, and the third that of the Essenes, as we have frequently told you.
Now, several places in, first primarily in the Wars, but in the Antiquities, he describes the Sadducees, Pharisees, and Essenes. And the passages more or less agree with them. The one in the Wars is the most extensive description of the Essenes, and we will look at those. So he's done this before, and here he uses sects. He uses the word philosophies or schools in other things. Exactly what he means by this is going to be something we'll talk about. What does he actually mean by a sect or a philosophy or a school? Anyway, go on.
For I thought that by this means I might choose the best if I were once acquainted with them all.
So he went on a spiritual quest. Go on.
So I contented myself with hard fare and underwent great difficulties and went through them all. Nor did I content myself with these trials only. But when I was informed that one, whose name was Bannus, lived in the desert and used no other clothing than grew upon trees and had no other food than what grew of its own accord, and bathed himself in cold water frequently, both by night and by day, in order to preserve his chastity, I imitated him in those things and continued with him 3 years. So when I had accomplished my desires, I returned back to the city, being now 19 years old, and began to conduct myself according to the rules of the sect of the Pharisees, which is of kin to the sect of the Stoics, as the Greeks call it.
This is not the only time he connects the Pharisees with the Stoics, but look what he does. He goes off into the wilderness and becomes the disciple of a man named Bannus, who is very likely, from his description, an Essene. Does this sound at all familiar?
John the Baptist.
Yeah. John the Baptist. Bannus is very similar to John the Baptist in the description of it. And when Jesus goes and becomes a disciple of John the Baptist, this is extremely similar to what Josephus does with Bannus. And in fact, that's what people did when they wanted to go and they connected themselves to a spiritual master, a guru, and they lived with them and they adopted their lifestyle. And notice it's in the wilderness. That is a very common theme. of Jewish asceticism at the time. The Essenes, even though groups of Essenes lived in the cities and towns, their headquarters was Qumran, which was in the wilderness. John the Baptist was probably an Essene, probably had been at Qumran. He is in the wilderness down in the Jordan River, just north of the Dead Sea. Jesus goes off into the wilderness. This is part of what it means to become a disciple of a spiritual master, and the purification and the asceticism. So Josephus lives, tries it out for 3 years. And by the way, that's an interesting period of time, because in the Qumran documents, in order to become a member of the community, it takes a 2 to 3 year period of apprenticeship, so to speak, or novitiate, if you want to use the Christian term, before that you were fully accepted into the community. So evidently Josephus goes through this period of initiation, decides he's, that's enough, goes back, and he identifies himself with the Pharisees. And that's what he does throughout his writing, is saying he's essentially a Pharisee. Even though he's a priest and member of the, you know, Jerusalem nobility, so to speak, which tended to identify with the Sadducees, he sees himself as a Pharisee.
Do we have enough other examples of this kind of thing to say that this was like the kind of a standard practice for Jewish leadership to, or kind of early rabbinic sources that follow a similar pattern? About people's lives, you should go.
Well, there's
we
a
know discipleship was there.
But yeah, yeah, we know discipleship, but the rabbis tended not to, the Pharisees tended not to do this sort of thing, but the Qumran people did, the Essenes did. This was an essential part of what it meant to become an Essene.
So he started as an Essene and decided
he says he tried out all of them. He doesn't tell us about his sort of, you know, what it means to try out being a Sadducee. But he definitely is living as an Essene for 3 years and then decides to go home and be a Pharisee. Okay. All right. Irma, do you want to carry on? You've got a copy. Number three.
Marion has a copy first.
Oh, okay. Sorry. So, okay. So,
go ahead.
Muriel, please, you read.
Okay.
But when I was in the 26th year.
But when I was in the 26th year of my age, it happened that I took a voyage to Rome, and this on the occasion which I shall now describe. At the time when Felix was procurator of Judea, there were certain priests of my acquaintance, and very excellent persons they were, whom on a small and trifling occasion he had put into bonds and sent to Rome to plead their cause before Caesar. These I was desirous to procure deliverance for, and was especially because I was informed that they were not unmindful of piety towards God, even under their afflictions, but supported themselves with figs and nuts. Accordingly, I came to Rome, though it was through a great number of hazards by sea, for as our ship was drowned in the Adriatic Sea, we were in it, being about 600 in number, swam for our lives all the night. Well, it was pretty storm. When upon the first appearance of the day and upon our sight of a ship of Cyrene, I and others, 80 in all, by God's providence, prevented the rest and were taken up into the other ship. And then when I had thus escaped and came to Dicearchia, which the Italians called Puteoli.
Okay, stop there for a second.
Sure.
So, again, it's under the procurator Felix, who's a terrible official. He's seized some priests. He's put them as hostage, basically arrested them. So Josephus, even though he's quite young, 26 years old, he's part of a delegation that's going to Rome to try and get their release by going to the Caesar. So he tells us these adventures. The ship sinks. They have to swim to the Italian shore. They manage to survive. But now it's an interesting point. Go on. I became acquainted.
And when I had escaped and was coming, I became acquainted with Aliturius, an actor of plays and much beloved by Nero, but a Jew by birth. And through his interest became known to Poppaea, Caesar's wife.
So in other words, he meets this Jewish actor who has a close connection with Nero's wife. And now he's building up his contacts in Rome, right? Go on, and took care.
And took care as soon as possible to entreat her to procure that the priests might be set at liberty. And when, besides this favor, I had obtained many presents from Poppaea, I returned home again.
So here it is. He's been to Rome. He's seen the power, and he gets connected with the imperial family. This is important stuff for a young man. But he comes from a, you know, he's not just Joe Blow. You know, he comes from a prominent family in Jerusalem. Otherwise, why would they send him at 26 years of age to Rome? He achieves the mission, and he makes really good connections while he does it. And this is going to show him in good stead later on.
He's a networker.
Yes, he's a networker. Absolutely. People, you know, your who you knew back then was extremely important. All right. Erman, do you want to pick it up at number four? Now I perceived.
And now I perceived innovations were already begun, and that there were a great many very much elevated in hopes of a revolt from the Romans. I therefore endeavored to put a stop to these tumultuous persons and persuaded them to change their minds and laid before their eyes against whom it was that they were going to fight and told them that they were inferior to the Romans not only in martial skill but also in good fortune, desired them not rashly and after the most foolish manner to bring on the dangers of the most terrible mischiefs upon their country, upon their families, and upon themselves. And this I said with vehement exhortation, because I foresaw that the end of such a war would be most unfortunate to us. But I could not persuade them, for the madness of desperate men was quite too hard for me.
Okay, so he leads, the delegation he leads is in 64, so it's a cup. He's skipping forward a bit, and we're not going to read any further because this will then go. When we get to the war, we'll look at the parts of it. But you see, he's connected to the moderates who try to stop the revolt. In other words, he's alighting a couple of years there together. Okay, so he's trying to stop the revolt. So we're going to skip ahead now to if you take a look. All right, we did that. He talks about what's going to happen in terms of the fighting and things like that, and he talks about the Jews defeating the Romans initially. But take a look now on number 7 on page 3. Cal, do you want to pick it up there? So when Gessius...
So when Gessius had been beaten, as we have said already, the principal men of Jerusalem, seeing that the robbers and innovators had arms in great plenty, and fearing lest they, while they were unprovided with arms, should be in subjection to their enemies, which also came to be the case afterward, and being informed that all Galilee had not yet revolted from the Romans, but that some part of it was still quiet, they sent me and two others of the priests, who were men of excellent characters, Joazar and Judas, in order to persuade the ill men there to lay down their arms and to teach them this lesson, that it were better to have those arms reserved for the most courageous men that the nation had than to be kept there, for that it had been resolved that those of our best men should always have their arms ready against futurity, but still so that they should wait to see what the Romans would do.
Okay, we're going to stop there for today. According to this account, he is appointed as the general of the Galilee. And if you just turn to page 759, this is his earlier account of that same event from the wars. Book 2, chapter 20, it's on page 759, number 3. Okay, he talks again about Cestius, who was the Roman military general who was defeated. And you'll see there that he, talking about the provisional government, he said they appoint many great generals for the war. And then where it says 563, it says Joseph also, the son of Gorion, and Ananus, the high priest, as governors. and so on and so forth. He goes on with that, and then he talks about who are all the other generals, and he mentions the fact that he talks about himself in the third person here. This is on number four, where it says 568. He says, as was Josephus, the son of Matthias, of both the Galilees. In other words, according to Josephus, he is appointed by the provincial government at the beginning of the revolt to be the general of the Galilee, the military commander of the Galilee. Now, he's quite young at this point. He's like 28 years old or something like that. Why, and he doesn't have shows any experience before that of military training or anything, we just have no idea. Nowhere is it really sort of, you know, put why they picked him. But they did. Okay, we will stop there. And for today, I'm going to stop the recording and then just say a few more words.
Maybe people aged faster at that point. Wow. Maturity.